that we need to know. But we may find out about that 5 minutes before we go in from social media, from public available information, and from our public affairs, who prints kind of a daily early bird for the African continent as well. So those are, you know, a lot of things that we're trying to look at, but trying to focus on primarily multi-int, multi-domain, taking open source and being able to apply that against what we have collected and what we already know, and then have some archive capability to do trends analysis that allows us to look at how we can do predictive analysis in the future.
Thank you, General. Does anyone else have any thoughts on trade-offs and investments between shared systems versus tailored systems?
Yeah, so at CENTCOM, I mean, we're always an 800-pound gorilla in a room. Everybody looks and says, hey, you have all the resources, the Department of Defense. That's probably true, but one of the things that I found coming down as a two at CENTCOM is one of the things that I think can handicap any organization is stovepipe systems or tailored things. Now, if you're an industry partner, which a lot of industry partners are out there, that may not sound very enticing to you because you make your money by developing solutions, and some of those solutions you may not want to share with some of your competitors. But from where I sit, you know, I'm not in the business of making money. I'm in the business of being effective so that we can achieve the goals that the combatant command has been given by the National Command Authority. And so I'm loath to look for a tailored solution that only works for United States Central Command. Because in this environment that we have now, it's a global environment. The players and actors in it span the globe, and we need to be able to interact with all the other combatant commands and all of our interagency partners and our national partners from other nations. So, you know, if you held me at risk, I would tell you that I would rather have a shared system than a tailored solution because of what I just mentioned. I think it's faulty to go down a tailored solution road.
Captain Stephenson.
I agree with that, sir. I think one area where there might be able to be a little bit of a distinction is that between the underlying data models and the applications. I mean, I think it's most important in the IC that our underlying structured data be a good object model that's as universally applicable as possible. And then it seems like at the application level, you'd be able to just let 1,000 flowers bloom. As long as they're tapping that common shared data, there'd be much, I think interoperability would flow much more naturally with specific combatant commands, even specific shops within those combatant commands, maybe even sort of an indie level of coding, coming up with the solutions they need, as long as that underlying data model is as widespread and as well governed as we can possibly make it.
So at SOCOM, we're in the throes of this right now. So I agree with General Henry. We have our own enterprise, the SOF enterprise, which comprises about 70 to 72,000 across the board. If you count our contractors, we're about 85,000. And then we establish all these relationships. Everything is by, with, and through, and we have tremendous relationships established with a variety of countries and partners around the world. And we saw in just recent, when you take a look at the recent Korea planning and a variety of other things, we realize that we're not connected. We have architecture issues, we have systems issues, we can't speak to one another. And I'm talking about inside the SOF enterprise. I'm not even talking about outside of the special operations community. So that was an eye-opener. So we've got the clarion call now to sort of impose ourselves as a SOCOM headquarters on what had always been an autonomous enterprise. So we have theater special operations commands that they work under a geographic combatant commander. We've got the Joint Special Operations Command, which is, you know, made up of a variety of task forces in many cases. And we cannot afford to not communicate or not to be able to touch common data sets. That is going to be crucial as we move forward with the NDS, and that's going to be some of the comments that I make here in a few minutes. The National Defense Strategy is very clear. It is China and Russia. And they're the big boys on the block, so we have got to get our collective act together as it relates to being able to communicate and being able to share information as rapidly as possible.
All right. So, Brigadier General Parker, can you tell us about the unclassified processing, assessment, and dissemination sites and the DOMOPS Awareness Assessment Response TOP, it's a mouthful, and how they support your mission? And additionally, do you have any lessons learned for the use of those systems that could be beneficial to the COCOMs?
Yeah, sure. So just as you're talking about a shared enterprise, anything you use to put lead to head also needs to be thought about of putting a head to a bed, right? So we're your first contact when your grandma needs to be saved in a domestic response. So we just need to think about those tools that we use overseas to save lives. Those tools can also be used in the United States to save lives and in those emergency events. So what we came out with was, let's take a look, and you will not hear me use the word intelligence, because what we do is information, and we do information sharing. And we do this because we have to talk to the lowest level first responder all the way up to other level federal agencies and our public partnerships. So we do not talk intelligence. That's a taboo word for them. That sends chills up their spine. And we talk about information and information sharing. So how do we do that? So we took a look across the force and said, let's look at some of this ISR force structure that we have that's sitting in the continental United States, and how can we use this in times of disaster response? And so we came out with looking first at the Air Force's DGS type capability, and we came up with the concept of UPAD. So a big portion to the UPAD is it's unclassified. We do this everything at the unclassified level. And the tool that helps us enable that then is DART, our DOMOPS Awareness Response Tool. And we are able to ingest large amounts of unclassified data. And it's network agnostic. It is platform agnostic, because we have to be able to talk to a disparate group of people across the entire field in the time of chaos and very small comms pipes and taking stuff from open source, not open source, publicly available information and taking stuff from national level systems that is then passed down to us at the unclassified level, ingesting a lot of geospatial data for us to be able to provide instantaneous assessments to those JTF commanders on the ground trying to respond and get the emergency responders in the right place at the right time. It's about saving lives. So what we've also found now, because of DART and our ability to be platform agnostic and network agnostic and the amount of data that we're ingesting at the unclassified level, we're now working with the Joint AI Center about helping us understand that data a little bit better and helping us to do some modeling now across the continental United States of places that are at risk. Risk for flooding, risk for earthquakes, risk for severe weather, just because of that large data set that we have. Our problem now is it's not necessarily as structured as it should be, but we're working with them to come up with some tools now that we can start to get into predictive analysis when we start seeing a hurricane on the horizon or places that may be to start to pre-position and get people at the right place to be able to affect this in a hurry. So when we talk about what can we do as the follow-up question, the good thing about the systems that we have developed, again, it's all unclassified. We can quickly tailor this through our unique relationships with the State Partnership Program in 78 countries in the world. We can pick this capability up and move it overseas to support Greg in AFRICOM when he has a humanitarian assistance disaster response kind of capability. We can pick this up and put it anywhere in the world because it's unclassified. And it's network agnostic again, and it's designed that it can work over small pipes or big pipes or any kind of pipe you want to bring to it. That we can take this overseas, we can train our partners on it, we can also quickly use it ourselves, we can put it any place you want because it's all unclassified. So we're able to put this in response of any COCOM that has an HADR type need, or we can take it overseas to continue building our partnerships overseas with our state partnership program.
Thank you, General.
Oop.
Mr. Lawless, we've heard a lot about the advances in technology, but advances also bring their own challenges. What challenges do you foresee, and what can you do to mitigate them?
All right, so I'll go back to the National Defense Strategy, which we try to embrace pretty much on a daily basis over at SOCOM. So the issue is violent extremism. I saw that, General Gibson. Violent extremism is still number one priority. There's no question about it. So we are to counter predominantly violent Sunni extremists around the world, usually manifested in ISIS and Al-Qaeda. So we have a global responsibility in that regard. So that doesn't go away. That will continue apace. But we feel, from a soft perspective, that we have a huge role to play in the competition space relative to the Chinese and the Russians, and to a lesser extent, but still, Iran. So in that vein, we're very concerned about the rise in smart technology from China in particular. You know, we as special operators at any given time, we have about 7,000 to 8,000 soft forces around the world in 88 countries. So when they travel, and if they're doing sensitive activities, or they're in a cover status or something of that nature, we have there's a direct threat to our forces and their identity management relative to the smart technology that exists in many countries around the world that's really pervasive by the Chinese. So that's one issue that we're concerned about from an advanced technology perspective. The other issue is, once again, partner integration. So I really do think that it's not necessarily, I think technology can solve the problem. It's really more of a culture issue that we have. And we do have a crisis in culture. Culture eats strategy for lunch. We've all heard that. But I think the problem that we face now is it's not the Five Eyes partners. So I will rant a little bit now. This is because I have the pulpit. So we talk about Five Eyes integration like it was the second coming. And I understand that, and that's absolutely crucial. And our Five Eyes partners are critical to what we do and what we're going to do in the future. But we have a variety of non-traditional partners that we rely on. So how do we inculcate them? How do we integrate them in what we do? What makes us different than the Chinese and the Russians is that we have special relationships. We invest in relationships. They do not. They have business investments. In some cases, it's detrimental to the nation that they're partnering with. But from a SOCOM perspective, it's all about establishing these relationships and establishing trust. So I do think that we have to change the way we just do business in this community, in the Defense Department and in the IC. And that really goes to, we over compartmentalize just about everything. We sequester and insulate a lot of the critical information that we absolutely need to share. And then we try to wait until the last possible moment to share the information when, I mean, things are happening instantaneously in 2019. And we do not have, we can't afford to do that moving forward in the future. So I think we do need to change the way we just conduct ourselves on a daily basis. We have to further integrate our partners. If that takes a no foreign waiver, then that's what we should do, to further inculcate those who are embedded in our staffs and in our formations. I know that there's a balance between security and really the mission, but what we really do need to make sure that we change the way we do business in the future as far as culture is concerned. So that's the way I'd leave it, Mike.
Great, thanks, sir. General Henry, how has your perspective changed moving from a service intel chief to a combatant command J2?
Okay, so you're making the assumption that everyone knows what a service intel chief is supposed to do.
Feel free to elaborate.
So my perspective, I don't think my perspective has changed at all, and I'll tell you what that perspective is in a minute, but certainly the mission has changed, and the mission is driving how I actually respond to the enemy and how I would approach the task of getting after that enemy. So first of all, on the perspective part, as an intel professional, my perspective has always been, and I don't think it's gonna change anytime in the near future, my perspective has always been is that we're behind and we're losing ground to our adversaries. For some of the reasons and some of the things that you've discussed here over the last couple of days, we know we're not gaining ground, and in some areas we're ceding ground to our adversaries when it comes to big data, when it comes to being able to share freely or more freely in a way that Keith was talking about. We know we're not where we need to be there. So I had that perspective when I was a director of intelligence for the Marine Corps, and I brought that perspective down here, and what I'm seeing so far has not changed that perspective, and instead it's probably helped me to see more clearly that the perspective is probably about right. I'm not an alarmist. I believe that there's things that we do well, but certainly just listening to some of the comments up here, there are some things that we know we are not doing that will give a warfighter an advantage, and we're not taking advantage of that. And the folks sitting in the audience here, with all the great technology and all the innovation and all the knowledge that's out there, can help us get to where we need to be. So we just need to sometimes get out of our own way. So so Service Intel Chief, Combatant Command, J2. First thing I would point out is, I don't know if you can see it in this light, but I did not have all this gray hair when I was a Service Intel Chief. And that was only about 6 months ago that I assumed the position. And General Gibson can appreciate that. But all joking aside, it truly is just a change in mission. As Headquarters Marine Corps, I was looking at the entire globe, helping the Commandant of the Marine Corps and the Deputy Commandants of the Marine Corps think through problems globally and how they affect manning, training, and equipping of Marine forces that provide capability to the Joint Force, and in this case, United States Central Command. What's interesting about the perspective or the situation I was in there was I had just come from a three-year tour as an operations officer for the J2 at United States Central Command, never thinking that I would come back to Central Command ever again. And so while I was up in DC, I very rarely paid attention to what was going on in CENTCOM, because everybody in the world was paying attention to what was going on in CENTCOM. I spent a lot of time looking at the Pacific, looking at Europe, looking at South America and places where we don't put a lot of resources, because I thought that's where we needed to spend more of our time for future adversaries and the things that you need to do to help a service get ready for the future, to provide forces to the combatant commanders going forward. Coming down to CENTCOM, obviously the mission changed, and what seems like a good thing, like you only have to focus on a certain area of responsibility, not the entire globe. Coming back home to CENTCOM, I realized that all that means is that I get to see the fire burning up close, as opposed to being back and just going, yeah, it looks hot. It really is hot. So. You know, I'm not telling anybody anything you don't know, but Central Command is on fire, and the Pentagon was hot, but it wasn't on fire. So hopefully you understand what I mean by that, and that's the perspective difference, you know. Fire is hot, everybody knows it. It seems to be hotter in CENTCOM. I think that's a truism for us, and so that's the difference I see in the two positions.
Great, thanks, General. Well, I would say he's closer to the war fight. I think we just lost two additional special operators last night in Afghanistan. So, you know, this is a tough business, and you're in it each and every day. So you're about as close to it as you could possibly get without actually being in combat.
All right. Thanks, gentlemen. So for a little bit different perspective, Captain Stephenson. TRANSCOM is unique because of its worldwide operating area and the fact that you need to function in the seam between the government and civilian sectors. DoD has many cyber challenges, but you are unique in your need to operate on classified and completely unclassified commercial networks. Can you discuss the challenges of intel support to cyber defense given your broad requirements?
Sure. Well, as General Lyons explained very ably yesterday, I think our reliance on commercial partners gives us a very large attack surface, we call it, in the cyber domain. So we're dealing with that in the J2 the best we can. Between the JIOC manning and the manning from an integrated planning element from CyberCom, which has an intelligence component, I think we have the personnel we need to make progress, but we are still working on how to best align those folks and how to task them. So when I'm thinking about that, I tend to maybe get drawn to thinking at a higher level about some about this domain. I think ever since cyberspace was recognized correctly as a warfighting domain, intelligence has been a little bit disoriented in it. I like to start by reminding myself that even our terminology here, cyberspace, cyber domains, you know, these are metaphorical descriptions for a complex set of interactions between like the physical, logical, and cognitive layers that we kind of collectively refer to as cyber. And I think that can lead us a lot of times to try to find our way ahead by deploying analogies to the physical warfighting domains in terms of how we should move forward in intel. And I think that's often useful, but I do think there are some limitations to it that stem from some inherent features in the cyber domain. And these are obvious, but I still think they're worth thinking about explicitly once in a while. I mean, the first one from an intel perspective that occurs to me is that while there are actors in cyberspace, there are not really orders of battle. So there aren't really any threat platforms that are constrained by quantity and by the laws of physics that allows us as analysts to deploy one of our most powerful weapons, which is deductive analysis. In other words, honing in on what is possible by eliminating what's impossible. In the cyber business, I'm not sure we can wisely assess that anything is impossible. And so what the upshot for intelligence is that one of the ways that we go about providing indicators, you know, we do indications and warning, especially for that sort of just beyond the horizon threat, is difficult for us to do in the cyber domain. Secondly, I think there's important differences between what we mean when we talk about what is intelligence and what's collection in this domain. We get good reporting on cyber threats from some UMINT and SIGINT, some of the traditional sources. But I've learned that what most of the folks in this room probably refer to as intel, a lot of times is, you know, information that's gleaned from observing adversaries at the boundaries of or inside our own networks or someone else's network, which means it's sort of an outgrowth more of cybersecurity operations than what we would otherwise call intelligence collection. And the implication of this, you know, for me is that I think that naturally pulls the skill sets and the technical competence of your intelligence cadre closer to that of the cybersecurity operators. And then some of those distinctions then sort of start to, there's pressure on those distinctions. I think you also see this on you know, the offensive side. If you use the example of like an AMRAAM, you know, the engineers who design and build that weapon have a completely different skill set than the pilots who employ it tactically in combat, who have a completely different skill set than the intelligence analysts who support that warfighting mission. Because of the inherently technical nature of cyberspace, I think that there's a lot more overlap between those different competencies. And for intel, that means I think it tends to draw our desired skill sets sort of higher up that S&T continuum compared to other warfare areas. You know, another way to say it is if you think about targeting in the kinetic domains, intelligence does a lot of its work from outside or above the target. In cyber, a lot of that work has to be done inside the target. And so the analogy, you know, the analogy of skill set there might be more like force reconnaissance in the Marines as opposed to like imagery analysis, for example. So look, we have lots of great analysts that are working at sort of the high level of cyber, that are assessing trends, they're linking incidents in cyberspace to geopolitical context. That keeps our leadership informed, it drives programmatics, it drives planning, so it's important work. I guess what I'm saying is I think it's really difficult at that level to provide actionable, predictive intelligence on threats, which is where military intelligence, I think, really has to earn a lot of its pay. Implications for the workforce. I mean, we have military people, uniformed personnel that are good at this, they're skilled at it. But I wonder if that's the best sustainable approach. I think, you know, we should obviously think about career paths for these folks that's much different, but whether they're in military or civilian, that recognizes that because of these skill sets, it doesn't make maybe a lot of sense to have them doing other things because of the value of what they do, and that they might not have the chance for broad exposure to different missions and warfare areas that we associate with the rest of the force. And then you could get into higher level questions about, you know, if your workforce really seems to adhere more to a civilian model than a military model, should the backbone of the force be military to begin with, and you know, I know that's been talked about at a very high level. But anyway, the takeaway for me in terms of intel support in this mission area is that the comparisons with the other warfighting domains, I think, can be useful, but I think we need to be cognizant that there are limits there, and that we have to be willing to be a little bit different, creative, and adaptive when it comes to training, manning, and even some expectation management of what intel can do in this warfare area.
So. Great, thank you, Captain.
Hey, I'd like to add a little bit to that. On the first day I was here, we talked about Mars and we talked about foundational data, and a question came up about cyber and what that would mean as you build out this foundation of data. And I think right now, we know that in the intel community, we haven't done that yet. We haven't defined those fields of data that would allow the folks at Stratcom or anyone that is addressing cyber issues to be able to mine for that kind of exquisite data. So I think as a community, we really do need the intel side of this. We need to really make sure we define as best we can what that foundational data needs to look like, and then start building toward that, as you say. But I think Mars and the way forward and that foundational data is something that we have to get right so that that quick pull, the quick query is there, and then you use those folks that have the exquisite skill sets to be able to build on that so that you can bring in a young Sergeant Henry and teach him some of the things that we need them to know in order to do that. I mean, it's to me, when we look at this, if you look back in the SIGINT community, you have young individuals coming in and they start working an ELINT problem, or they start working signals. And at the very beginning, they don't have a foundational knowledge that they need to go after signals that are very complex. But over time, we're able to build that skill set. I think as students start getting into the workforce, they're digital natives. They actually come in at a level that's a little bit higher. And I think if we get the foundational data right and we put them in front and we build that capability, I think we can do that. But the dilemma is, as stated, you know, what do you do now and how do you build that capability and capacity quickly? But you know, I'm a military guy. It's all about sustainment, and I need to be able to sustain that capability over time. So the dilemma is, how do you balance that? So, you know, good luck balancing that. I think that's the Mars piece is key to getting this to a level where it's usable.
And any other comments from the panel?
So I'd just like to add to that as well. As we look at our standardized data and what are our requirements for that, I think that's key. And General Henry talked about this, but be able to make sure we've got the right data sets that are discoverable, they're searchable, we can archive, we can go back and look them up. And then we look at the tools that we're able to make, and we talked about the applications that we can put into play. And along with what I talked about earlier with the modernization strategy for AFRICOM, it's the ability to use what's already being provided across the combatant commands and by DIA, and the tools and the capabilities that are really quite exceptional. But being able to maintain at the speed of technology that we need to be able to do, to be able to continue to engage with, on the AFRICOM side, with our African partners, and the amount of technology that's being provided by China on Africa, within Africa. We're deploying an Africa data sharing network across some of the countries to be able to provide some collateral information back and forth, and to get not only push information to them that we collect and that we can write to release for them, but also get some information back from them. And that's been challenging based on just having a network that we can rely on. A lot of our African partners say, hey, don't worry about the network. We'll just get Huawei to come in and build that network for us, and we'll put your system on that network. So that's been a little challenging for us to be able to do that. But it's also brought some of our African partners into a more mature look at what we're doing with information sharing and how we do intelligence, and really, you know, starting at the bottom level to train them on what that means and what type of applications they're using, what they need. So a little different perspective on that, as well as we look at on the African continent, how we're going to look at defeating the cyber capabilities brought in by the Chinese. How will we compete with, or more importantly on our side, how do we develop the plans and operations to complicate what plans that the Russians and the Chinese have there as part of what we've talked about today about the national defense strategy. Although kind of a stretch for AFRICOM, but we've got to be a part of that to be part of what the SecDefs talks about is, you know, that's going to be our priority. Those are our priorities to look at. So again, from a data perspective, looking at standardized data and how we can use that both on the continent in support of the national defense strategy, and then being able to acquire and enhance and turn over our technology quicker than the adversary. I think that's a big deal for us. So on the continent of Africa, from a simple perspective of foreign military sales, if they need ammunition, weapons, 3-year process for the United States, but Russia and China can very quickly bring that in. So what does that mean when we get into technology, SIGINT technology, other collection technology, technology from an ISR perspective for collection management, exploitation, and so on? How do we stay ahead of that? And that's part of the larger requirement that we all need to be cognizant of is, what's our acquisition process going to look like? How through innovation can we fail quickly to get to those wins? How do we need to provide the right capability that we need to have on the across the combatant commands as well in supporting the Department of Defense?
I think from a SOCOM perspective, we don't do this well enough. We talk about cyber all the time and intel support to cyber. So we have a tendency to want to rely on cybercom, and cybercom is just not enough to go around. So instead of just growing your own cyber capability, I think we have to start looking at how do we protect our networks, how do we be more aggressive, even from an offensive cyber perspective. That we're in information wars. That's what we're involved in influence and information warfare. We're in conflict with the Chinese and the Russians at the very least in the cyber domain. We at SOCOM, we want to operate more in the information sphere. So we almost view that as the next generation of ISR to a certain extent. Not everything's going to be airborne ISR and maritime platforms and things of that nature. We really want to operate inside where the enemy is located, and the enemy, all five of them, are operating inside this larger digital domain. And that's that cyber sphere. Now, there's a lot of authorities and approvals that come with that. So how do we operate in there where it really is no AOR? It's sort of a Dodge City to a certain extent. So this is going to be, the next challenge for us. It's a challenge that we face now where we want to operate more effectively in this arena. And it's both protecting our networks, which is a daily chore, but it's also bringing it to the enemy in a more effective way, which I think we do it at the tactical level pretty darn well. But at the operational and strategic levels, I think we have a ways to go.
On this front, speaking from the National Guard perspective, we do have some unique authorities for helping with the cyber domain, and we're beginning to discover ourselves within that domain and our different authorities and statuses that we can hold as a guardsman. Title 10, which kind of takes us out of the home game, and our Title 2 authorities, how do we work with lead federal agencies and a Title 32 status with the federal assistance that we have, and then the unique authorities working directly underneath the governor in a state active duty status. And each one of those gives us unique authorities and gives us tailored, flexible response capability or defense capabilities. And we're trying to figure that out and grow those, especially as we start looking at protecting the state election systems coming up this year. How do we influence that, and how do we get inside that to leverage the unique cyber capabilities that are in the Guard? So when we take this out just a little bit more, how do we're doing this inside the continental United States gets really sticky.
Exactly. All right, it looks like we have maybe a few more minutes. We probably entertain one, maybe two questions. Does anybody have any questions from the audience? Going once, going twice. Can't see. Oh, okay.
Gentlemen, leaders and commanders always have something that keeps them up at night. What's that that keeps you up at night and why?
I would say that, you know, quite honestly, so where you sit is where you stand. So I'm in the soft enterprise. First and foremost is this radical element that we face on a consistent basis. I'm fearful that, you know, we're going to have two operatives walk in the Mall of America strapped with suicide vests, and they're going to with a couple of AKs, and they're going to kill 350 Americans over the holiday period. The China-Russia thing will go out the window like that. The American people will, understandably, be outraged and say, well, what are you doing? How come you're not more effective against this enemy? You haven't defeated them. And we haven't defeated them. Their proto-state is gone, at least from an ISIS perspective. The intent is still there. They still recruit. They still have expanded or metastasized this cancer. You know, we excised the tumor, but it's in the lymph system. And it's—I don't want to be alarmist about it, but this is our primary responsibility. So I'm still very concerned that something like that is going to occur, because that's the homeland. Now, I think the Russians and the Chinese are somewhat pragmatic. They don't want to go to war with the United States. I'm convinced of that. We don't want to go to war with them. So I do think that there is a practical nature in dealing with the Chinese and the Russians, although we do have to deal with them. There's no question about it. But I am concerned about this violent extremist problem that we still face.
I mean, Keith touched on it earlier. You know, the human cost of what we do and the decisions that are made based on the intelligence that we provide or the intelligence that we don't get to provide. And I would tell you, all the things that we've been talking about here the last few days, those things concern me. I'm not very fearful of a lot of things, but what concerns me is that when I come back here, wherever here is for DoDIIS Worldwide 5 years from now, what concerns me is that I think we'll probably be talking about the same thing. We'll be talking about the inability to share data. The data's not right. I haven't optimized the data. I don't have data standards that allow the industry to build whatever they need to build because they are innovative, and I know it's going to work with what I have because we provided those standards. That, to me, is a pervasive thing, and it is something that we have to solve. And so, you know, it'd be very easy for me to say what keeps me up at night is that we have lives on the line every day forward. But we're military professionals. We know what our calling is and what we're about. And so that's there always. But the thing that bothers me most is that we continue to talk about problems. You know, I tell my teams, I use the frog on the log. I don't know if it's an analogy or whatever the heck it is, but I always talk about these 12 frogs sitting on a log, and they all decided to jump. And I always ask my team, you know, what? I came back 4 hours later, how many frogs were sitting on the log? And, you know, you can give whatever answer you want. But the point is, it doesn't matter that they decided to do anything. It matters that they took action. And I can tell you, I've been coming to the DoDIIS Worldwide a couple of times and other forums, and we're all talking about doing the same things, and no one is actually doing it. We're just talking about it, talking around it. So my concern is that we continue to come together and talk about it, talk around it, and never ever solve those things that in my, you know, country boy away from Texas, they seem to be pretty dang simple to me. Pretty simple to me. Get the data right. Let industry know what it needs to look like and how to interface with it, and then let them help us get at our problems. And for some reason, we can't fundamentally get that right. And I think if I'm going to be fearful of anything, it's going to be that we never get it right. And I think we're better than that. And for those folks that were killed yesterday, we have to be better than that.
And that's my concern. I wouldn't say it's a fear. I hope I'm wrong.
I'd like to amplify. That's great. One thing I'd like to amplify that Dimitri talked about is, we are doing some good things, though. I mean, if you asked me 5 years ago, would we have something called a data scientist in our formation, or that we would hire a chief data officer, or that we would transition the J6 community to a chief information officer, I would say, I wouldn't see that coming. But because we are in this information war, and we're fighting for influence of various demographics and populations around the world, to include our own, to a great extent. And I think that we do recognize that we have tremendous shortfalls, and I think we're trying to take steps to fix it. I'm just thankful that we're bringing in the talented and skilled people that are necessary, because I'm an anachronism when it comes to this kind of stuff. You know, I'm a throwback to an earlier era. So we do need to bring on the talent and skill sets that are required to make us more effective in this this influence war that we're involved in.
All right, I think that's about all the time that we have. I want to thank our panelists for participating today.
Thank you. Thanks, Captain. Appreciate it. Good job. Thanks, General. Good job. Thanks. Good job. Good job. Good job. Great.
Okay, now it's my distinct pleasure to introduce our next speaker. She has an illustrious 32-year career in the intelligence field, and her current position, which she assumed about 3 months ago, is the Deputy Director for National Intelligence for National Security Partnerships, and most importantly, my boss, Lieutenant General Karen Gibson.
Thanks, Mike. Good afternoon. I am so pleased to follow this panel of warfighters, and I hope that you found their insights and observations as enlightening as I did. It is always good to hear from the field, from the user community that we exist to support, because we pursue DoDIIS improvements, not because we can necessarily, or because technological improvements and enhancements have made that possible, or even because someone has given us money and a mandate to do so. We pursue DoDIIS improvements because that's what warfighters need, and in this case, the intelligence team that supports them. The competitions and rivalries that are facing the U.S. are not passing trends or momentary problems. And one of my key themes is that without significant DoDIIS improvements, our nation will lose its competitive edge, and we may no longer be able to ensure that America's military superiority endures, or that our military, in combination with other elements of national power, stands ready to protect Americans and their interests against the increasingly sophisticated challenges to national security that we face. We should not lose sight of the fact that this remains our ultimate aim. I'm not an IT professional, and so along the lines of the previous panel, I want to offer a user's perspective, and I think you'll find that my comments in many ways reinforce some of the things that they had to say. My aim is to make a case for dramatic change and to establish a strong sense of urgency for that charge, that change, although it'd be hard to top General Henry's urging there, by painting a picture of what I believe future warfare could look like, probably will look like. I think it'll be clear to anyone who uses or works with our DoDIIS systems that our current architecture, systems, tools, processes, networks, and especially our methods of operating, our user practices, are not adequate, will prove insufficient in an environment of potential conflict with another nation state. So I've been at the Office of the Director of National Intelligence since April. I spent the 2 years before that as the CENTCOM J2, preceding Dimitri Henry, who you just heard from, and working closely with Captain Henry Stephenson, who was the NAVCENT N2 in Bahrain at the time. Before that, I was the J2 at Operation Inherent Resolve, working the Defeat ISIS campaign in Iraq and Syria, following and building on the progress that my predecessor, now Major General Jeff Cruz, had established in that position. And I think that in any of those jobs, but particularly deployed forward in an expeditionary manner against an unexpected contingency, we felt that our DoDIIS network capabilities were inadequate. And I'm sure Jeff would second that if he were here. So whether it was our complete inability for 3 years to connect the forward headquarters in Baghdad to DIA analysts at the MARC with analysts at our headquarters in Kuwait simultaneously on a three-way Tandberg, never could do it. Whether it was the lack of advanced analytic tools available for tactical users to process the huge volumes of data which were coming into us, or the limited pipes that connected our fusion center to databases in CONUS, which hindered our ability to make use of the tools that are routinely available to national agencies, analysts at national agencies, we were dissatisfied and frustrated. We were angry, cranky users. I was a squeaky wheel. And I say none of that to disparage the valor, fidelity, or honor of the DoDIIS team. I am not maligning anybody's patriotism or work ethic. Every IT professional with whom I worked, without exception, bent over backwards to do everything within their power to support our mission. They were unquestionably committed to our cause. And ultimately, we prevailed. I'm very proud of the role that my team played in that 12-month Mosul campaign, Operation Eagle Strike, moving up the Tigris River Valley, establishing an alternate bridge site in Kiara, conducting a deliberate targeting campaign in Mosul as a prelude to ground operations that liberated millions of Iraqi citizens from ISIS control. We also liberated Manbij, we liberated Raqqa, we destroyed the ISIS media wing, and we eliminated the physical caliphate that reducing their area of control that once extended along the entirety of Turkey's border with Syria, across into Iraq and all the way down to the gates of Baghdad. We reduced that to a tiny pocket at the base of the Baghouz Cliffs in the MERV, the Middle Euphrates River Valley. So thank you, Team DoDIIS, for your critical support, despite my complaints. You were absolutely essential to our ultimate success, and we would have been dead in the water without you. But since I moved to the ODNI in April, I have gained a more global perspective. And I realized that the entire intelligence enterprise that I relied on at CENTCOM would prove inadequate in so many ways in a future conflict against anything other than a campaign against violent extremist organizations. Such a conflict would be tremendously different, and we heard in particular Mr. Lawless several times talking about China and Russia in terms of scale, numbers, intensity, volume, lethality. So let's consider for a moment what conflict with nations like China, Russia, North Korea, or Iran would look like. These are all potential adversaries that are described in various national security documents. And let me be clear from the beginning, I am not advocating conflict with any of these nations. I do not ever want to go to war with them, but he who desires peace prepares for war, right? I think that's Plato or a Roman general somewhere. I certainly believe in that and strive to live it every day. So one clear difference in such warfare, and this isn't really new, but it would definitely be a challenge, is that we are in competition, the tyranny of size and distance that we would face. And we are in competition with nations that are very large, China, Russia, and Iran, at any rate, with significant military and civilian infrastructure. Unlike conflicts of the last 15 years, we would not be in a situation where we ran out of targets. But we would have the opposite problem of needing to identify and prosecute targets at speed and scale. And so we would be faced not only with the challenges of sheer numbers simultaneously, but also numerous mobile targets. Are we ready to find, fix, and maintain custody on vast numbers of mobile targets? And while we're doing that, to make assessments of the damage done and decisions about restrike in real time, while simultaneously defending against a potential onslaught of munitions against our own forces. In short, targeting in high-end warfare would look nothing like the Mosul targeting campaign. Another tremendous difference we would face in conflict against a real nation state is A2AD, anti-access area denial, our adversary's ability to prevent some, perhaps many of our forces, both weapon systems and collection platforms, from approaching within effective weapon or collection range. We're talking air defense systems, anti-ship ballistic missiles, et cetera. And yes, we've had adversaries that engaged our aircraft in several instances across the Middle East, but we have faced nothing along the scale of what we would be up against in confronting a nation state with a sophisticated IADS or integrated air defense system. Our adversaries would deny us other capabilities as well. They've studied us in our conflicts over the last 30 years, and they've seen areas where the U.S. has been successful and, accordingly, have pursued tactics, weapons, and other capabilities that would deny or limit our success. For instance, the U.S. has demonstrated that robust communications are critical to modern warfare, so they are developing capabilities to deny or disrupt our military communications, and perhaps even the civilian or commercial infrastructure or backbones that underlie our capacity, whether that's within the United States or in other nations where our communications transit. It's also conventional wisdom that we should expect sophisticated cyber attacks. But might our most technologically advanced adversaries also use AI, artificial intelligence, against our AI, or take actions that create doubt or cause us to question the veracity of the information that our AI systems are generating for decision or strike? It's scary stuff. So rest assured, I am not putting the onus for all of this on the shoulders of the DoDIIS community alone to redress. The user community has plenty of work to do in terms of collection platforms, analytic tradecraft, doctrine, workforce development, plain old training and exercises, and I'll touch on a few of those things throughout. But I'd like to take a few moments to describe what I think are some of the implications of potential high-end warfare for the DoDIIS community. User demands, if you will. What do we need from you? Well, I think the easy answer is that everything we've been doing for the past 20 years, we need to do faster and at a greater scale while defending against novel kinetic and non-kinetic capabilities. And when I say that I want to do things faster, I don't actually mean I want to do exactly the same things in exactly the same way, only faster. We need to operate differently, dramatically differently. And this is where much of the onus rests actually with the user community. It's not about throwing more money and people at our problems or running faster along the same path. So for instance, in a simple example, if there's an organization that can only handle vetting 20 targets a week, I don't want to give them five times the number of people so that they can manage 100 targets. What they need to do, what I need them to do, is to use technology and DoDIIS improvements to revolutionize the way they do business and to operate in extremely different ways. Users need to shift from what are largely, I think, late 20th century industrial era man-in-the-loop processes to 21st century data-driven processes that look entirely novel. But back to DoDIIS. So we need to be faster, more integrated, more transparent, and more diverse. We must adapt to an uncertain future and build in flexibility. We've got to be able to operate at the edge in a communications denied environment, which means we have to have the tools and capabilities at the point of need. And I'll use another example from my experience, this one again at Operation Inherent Resolve. So as collection challenged as I sometimes felt we were, our fusion center had great difficulty, especially initially, sorting through the various feeds of raw data to make meaning of them. And I often felt like I was looking for a needle in a haystack of needles. I was having flashbacks to my days as a young company-grade officer up in Alaska when literally we kept our electronic order of battle on 3x5 cards in a shoebox. And if someone left the tent flap open too long, they all blew out of order and you had to restack them. I felt like I was living back in that era. So we invited some data scientists and senior analysts from NRO, NGA, and NSA to come out and see what we were trying to do with our data and offer some recommendations or perhaps solutions. And they very generously agreed and sent a team of highly specialized folks out to Camp Arifjan who sat down, sat with us, saw what we were trying to do, and said, oh, actually, we do this back at the headquarters. Let me show you. Oh, I can't access those tools from forward, or, well, the bandwidth is too small for us to make use of this capability, or we could do this, but the latency involved in going back to your data, which resides in the States, is too great. And so we were kind of stuck back with that, looking for a needle in a haystack of needles for the rest of my time. At any rate, the point is we have to have the tools and the capabilities, not only at the national agencies, but at the point of need. We must rely on artificial intelligence in order to process an almost infinite quantity of data. And I'll cite Dash Jamison, the Air Force A2, who's been saying for a long time, we already live in an infinite world. You know, we collect more data than we can process. We process more data than we can analyze. We analyze more data than we can possibly produce products on. We produce more products than any analyst could ever read. And I don't know about you, Henry, but speaking personally, I always had more products in my read book than I could. I asked for all of them, but I had more products in my read book than I could ever digest and really retain. So it's an infinite world, and I'm eager to apply artificial intelligence to that. We must be resilient and able to withstand electronic attack, cyber attack, and attacks against space and communications infrastructure. We must maintain data integrity. Neither analysts nor algorithms can be effective if data is compromised. And I've already talked about the dangers of casting doubt on decisions for strike or other kinds of operations. We must have means to counter potential spoofing. We must allow for the rapid sharing of intelligence with mission partners while minimizing the need for human review. And this kind of gets at a means of automating the foreign disclosure process, which is another very 20th century, many people in the loop, hard to, as we currently operate, to automate and make much faster despite the heroic efforts of our FDO teams. I've never met an FDO who didn't want to help. But this is really a line of effort that needs a different means of operating. We'll need technology to support our coalition operations, as some of our previous speakers highlighted. But as we move forward as fast as we possibly can with technical enhancements and innovations, I don't want those to outstrip our partners' capabilities and funding, because I don't want to fight alone, and we don't have time for sneakernet. We must be structured in a way that can drive decisions at all levels, accounting for need to know and division of labor while maximizing interoperability internally between intelligence partners and externally with coalition partners. We have to organize and adapt to capitalize on our national data holdings and the technological convergence ongoing between different INTs, intelligence disciplines, SIGINT, OSINT, et cetera, between human capital, our intelligence community, our communications providers, our signal regiment in Army terms, and the cyber community, between different kinds of data, that which is exquisitely collected or that which is available through business or commercial sources, and various sectors, not just across the IC, with non-Title 50 partners, with the rest of federal, state, and local partners, and with private partners as well. And finally, our processes must be ubiquitous and seamless with shared resources and data that freely crosses across boundaries and moves globally, and this is key. And Dimitri and some of the others touched on this. We've got to be able to collaborate and integrate, not just across the IC, but also with the operations community, with the targeting community, with joint fires effect cells, and with those who are actually employing weapon systems. And not just in one combatant command, but across multiple combatant commands, probably globally, and with coalition partners too. Dimitri said it well. We need to operate in a collective global environment. So I'll cite one more user example of what I mean. In the spring of last year, you may know that the United States was joined by the United Kingdom and France in attacking Assad's chemical infrastructure in Syria. We launched weapons from air and sea-based platforms from three very different locations, from the Mediterranean, from the Red Sea, and from the Gulf, all against a handful of what we believe to be meaningful targets. We were all in the battle bridge. I know UCOM was on board, NAVUR was on board, STRATCOM was on board. We did not have a collective electronic COP or an operation picture or an intelligence picture. And we had, this was a first at CENTCOM, we had French and Brits in our battle bridge while this was ongoing, and everything we shared with them was pieces of paper. That high-end conflict that I described, there's no such thing, there will be no such thing as a regional conflict. Any high-end conflict is going to affect NORTHCOM, TRANSCOM, STRATCOM, SPACECOM, CYBERCOM as a minimum, as well as those who are engaged in the kinetic fight. What I've just described, which seemed pretty high-end and exquisite to us at the time, is going to be kindergarten compared to the kinds of collaboration we would need to do electronically and globally for a high-end conflict. Because I truly believe there's no such thing as a regional conflict anymore. So that's quite a challenge. What are we going to do about it? Well, frankly, I hope that the entire point of this whole conference was looking at ways that we can make those needed improvements. And we are making progress toward producing the robust and flexible systems that are necessary to prepare our nation for future conflict. And I hope sometime this week you've had the opportunity to hear from either John Sherman, our ICCIO, or his deputy, Linnea Jones talk about where we're headed with EyeSight Epic 3. And I hope you've heard about ways that we are harnessing artificial intelligence or machine learning, things like USDI's Project Maven, Lieutenant General Jack Shanahan's initiatives under the JAIC, or any number of similar efforts that are aimed to harness advanced analytics and high-end computing to make us more efficient, more effective, and more lethal. And finally, I hope you've heard from Lieutenant General Bob Ashley, Jack Gumto, and the DIA team about what's needed in terms of JWICS resiliency, or where we're headed with the transition from MIDB, modernized integrated database, to MARS, which stands to fundamentally change nearly every aspect of the way that we do targeting. My organization, ODNI's National Security Partnerships team, works with the Department of Defense and Services to ensure that the intelligence community is responsive to defense needs and requirements. And in particular, I want to ensure that the IC collectively is prepared to support the kind of globally integrated operations conducted across all theaters and domain boundaries, as I've described. So DIA's MARS, Machine-Assisted Analytic Rapid Repository System, is one of the most important efforts toward that end. I think many of you have heard of MARS. I hope you had the opportunity to receive some briefings this week. It's our future system for managing foundational military intelligence, the basic information on the locations of infrastructure, equipment, and military units. As someone who has had experience with MIDB, our current FMI system, I am excited about moving to a flexible system that will take advantage of modern capabilities, particularly the ability to ingest massive amounts of data without human intervention. Another example, a positive one, of where we're moving ahead to do business differently based on the capabilities that IT will provide us. Last year, DIA issued a broad agency announcement seeking proposals to help us improve our ability to ingest data, to discover data while keeping it secure, and importantly, to track moving targets, which is something MIDB absolutely cannot do. The response to the BAA, as I understand, has been outstanding. Jack will correct me if I'm wrong. But the project is far from complete. And I understand there will be a MARS Industry Day up in the National Capital Region next month, and would encourage your participation and focus on this key program. I should also emphasize that MARS is not the only effort that's underway. Last year at the DoDIIS conference, Sue Gordon, who was our principal deputy director of national intelligence, talked to you about how NSA, NGA, and NRO are using artificial intelligence tools for a broad range of efforts that include human language, image processing, and activity detection. Since last year's conference, the DNI has issued the AIM initiative, a strategy for augmenting intelligence using machines to provide an overall strategy for AI development while ensuring that the legal, policy, cultural, technical, and structural challenges are being addressed holistically. This strategy guides the IC's development of artificial intelligence capabilities while leveraging and complementing efforts that are underway within the Department of Defense. So back when I was a junior officer, if you were worrying about systems, that meant you weren't doing real intelligence work. But I had one stint as the deputy J2 systems officer at U.S. Forces Korea, and that quickly disabused me of that notion. And so with that in mind, as I looked through Linnea's description of EyeSight Epic 3, I understood how it really potentially will translate into an entirely different intelligence model, and I find that very exciting. I've described our requirement in high-end conflict for ubiquitous and seamless capabilities operating at scale across the IC information environment. So EyeSight Epic 3 will fully operationalize many of the IT enablers that we need for this. And I'll highlight just a few of the things that are in the works that EyeSight Epic 3 will tackle. First, next-gen computing services, multi-vendor, multi-fabric, interoperable clouds. Henry, you may already know this, but I've learned since I left CENTCOM that multi-fabric is a fancy IT word for multiple classification networks. Anyways, so next-gen computing services, you probably knew it. Multi-vendor, multi-fabric, interoperable clouds that provide reliable, dynamic, and innovative IT services with secure access to functions, capabilities, and data anywhere, anytime, and are reciprocally secure. Another one would be ICAM, Identity, Credential, and Access Management Capabilities for Assured Information Sharing, a fundamental enabler for intelligence integration. Third would multi-fabric cross-partner collaboration services, such as enterprise-wide chat capabilities and user mobility that would allow us to collaborate with external partners, both foreign and domestic, as well as within and across different fabrics or classification networks. Multi-fabric data capability and solutions to ensure that data is discoverable, accessible, and usable across the enterprise. Data center modernization and control to support current and future storage demands, which are huge, as we upgrade existing data centers to support multi-fabric IC ops and to provide the necessary advancements to support the very substantial storage requirements of the IC moving forward. IT accessibility and edge computing, I would love to have this in Kuwait, to ensure that all users can access the information they need, spreading tools and applications to nodes like the Snowball Edge device that will replicate capabilities forward and allow computing at the edge, much as I had been asking for. Knowing that our adversaries will seek to deny, degrade, and disrupt our communications, we cannot build a single exquisite system and then fall back on paper and field phones when we can't connect. We must have access to advanced capabilities and data when isolated from the broader network, and this IT accessibility and edge computing should give us that. And finally, EyeSight Epic 3 will bring us future network rationalization, the logical collapsing of unneeded or unstandardized networks within the IC information environment to increase security, reduce redundancies, and improve performance. So Greg Hadfield from AFRICOM talked about the importance of OSINT in social media on the African continent. Top secret networks used to be the richest environment for information, but with the growth of commercial collection capabilities, open source, publicly and commercially available information, I think in future it may be our unclassified networks, which are will be a primary place for intelligence analysts to operate, and will want to work on the data where it lies, whether that's a secret, a top secret, or an unclassified network. So I hope I've made the case throughout my remarks for why we need to change, for why warfighters, operators, and the IC that supports them require dramatic improvements in our ability to rapidly process, analyze, and disseminate vast amounts of data, even in a contested environment, to ensure our continued superiority against the increasingly sophisticated challenges to our national security. And I hope I've also conveyed a sense of urgency for this while highlighting some of the work that is already underway. We have a high bar and a lot of work ahead of us. So here's what it will take from you, from us. We need both patience and a sense of urgency. As Dimitri highlighted, we cannot be complacent. We need continual interaction with and feedback from the user community. And as an example, but it's only one, because I've mentioned a couple places where I think users really have to think about how are we going to operate differently. Mars and targeting. You know, the first time I got a Mars brief, I said, from this moment forth, Mars and the targeting community must be in a close and continuous dialogue because the way we do targeting and targeting requirements inform what Mars needs to look like, but what Mars is going to look like is going to change the way we do targeting. And so this dialogue between users and those who are building the systems, our CIOs and CDOs, must be close and continuous. We need what we need to do is not always going to be what we prefer to do. So we will need a willingness to change across the board in every community. And along with that willingness to change, we will need an equal commitment to see it through. And that's where the patience comes in. And finally, we will require your all-in collaboration and a joint commitment to a corporate approach. I want to thank you for your time and your attention today, the last afternoon of a conference. I know it's tough. I look forward to your continued collaboration and intellectual discussion on these important topics because our national security depends on it. Thank you.
Up next, we have Congressman Charlie Crist and following him, Lieutenant General Thomas Bergeson. We're going to take a short networking break for the next 25 minutes. I ask that you be back by 2:25. Our next two speakers made some time out of the day to come speak with us later this afternoon, so I ask that you return promptly at 2:25, and we will get started with closing out the rest of the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The program will begin in 10 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The program will begin in 5 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The program is about to begin. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The program is about to begin. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The program is about to begin. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. It is my honor to introduce Congressman Charlie Crist from the U.S. House of Representatives representing Florida's 13th District. Congressman Crist was elected to the Florida State Senate in 1992 and served two terms prior to being elected Florida Attorney General. He later became Florida's 44th governor and currently represents Florida's 13th District, covering Pinellas County from Clearwater down through St. Pete. Fun fact about Congressman Crist is he played quarterback for Wake Forest. Please welcome Congressman Charlie Crist.
Good afternoon and welcome to Tampa Bay. How many Floridians are there in the room? Go Florida. Finally, the sun came back out. I don't know how long you've been here. I guess you got here on Sunday, but usually we get rain every afternoon here, and it lasts for about 45 minutes, and then it goes away. And about the past 3 weeks, we've had it almost all day long, every day. So you brought us some good weather. Thank you so much for that. It's an honor to stand here today with all of you, surrounded by some of the brightest minds in national defense, intelligence, and cybersecurity. Watching the news, national security is often framed as something that can only be done or preserved by working alone in silos. But by working in government, I have learned that the most crucial aspect of effective defense is collaboration, working together, exactly what you're doing here at this conference, to make our world a safer place to live, work, and play. In other words, we can't do it alone. And that's why I'm so grateful to see all of you here gathered together, working towards our shared goal of a safer and more peaceful world. As you know, Florida is at the forefront of this collaboration. We're home to not one, but three unified combatant commands: U.S. Southern Command, U.S. Central Command, and U.S. Special Operations Command. In Tampa Bay alone, there are over 1,000 defense contractors in operation, developing cutting-edge technology for use by our military. In fact, just yesterday, I met with the Florida Defense Contractors Association and was struck by the level of expertise and innovation we have right here in the Sunshine State, and it grows by the day. Synergy between our intelligence community and private enterprise is one of the greatest strengths of our national defense, bringing together experts from diverse backgrounds to solve difficult problems and inform one another of potential threats. In an increasingly interconnected world, the threats we face are increasingly complex and require collaboration between every level of our government, from our local police force to the highest levels of military leadership. But as our enemies grow in sophistication, it's imperative we develop the tools and strategies to counter them, modernizing our information technology, infrastructure, and building our cybersecurity capabilities. From my position as a member of the Appropriations Committee, I'm proud to support a robust national defense that emphasizes innovation and sustainability, preparing for the threats of tomorrow as well as today. Just this past month, I'm very proud to have voted for the Bipartisan Budget Act that would increase investments in our national defense while avoiding catastrophic cuts, thinking ahead rather than playing catch up. And it's been a long time since Congress has done that. And I will continue to put America's security first by supporting the men and women who keep us safe, whether it's on the front lines or behind the scenes. So thank all of you for coming together to defend our great nation. Nothing is more important. Shortly after I got elected to Congress, I took a few days, the weekend after that election in November of 2016. I was at a hotel in Southwest Florida. It was that Saturday after that Tuesday election, and I was by the pool, and it was a pretty relaxed atmosphere. And some people may have had a few more beverages than they should. And this one lady approached me and she said, "Didn't you just get elected to Congress?" And I said, "Yeah." I felt like saying guilty. And she said, "Well, I have one message for you. Make sure, as a member of Congress, you put my family's safety first." And I try to do that every day, and it's what you do every single day of your lives. God bless you, and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Congressman Crist. Let's give him another round of applause, please. Our next speaker is Lieutenant General Thomas Bergeson, who currently serves as the United States Air Force Deputy Commander of the United States Central Command. Throughout his career, he's commanded a fighter squadron, operations group, fighter wing, numbered Air Force, and has held various staff assignments. Prior to his current assignment, he served as the commander of the 7th Air Force, Pacific Air Forces, and Osan Air Force Base, South Korea. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Thomas Bergeson.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. If I'm looking at the schedule correctly, I represent the last speaker of this conference besides the closing remarks. So all of you to be commended for sticking it out. Gold stars for everybody. There's two ways to look at being the last speaker in the lineup. One way to look at it is like a baseball team, and I'm batting ninth, where teams normally stick their worst hitters. You've all seen the train wreck at bats with a pitcher up there trying to swing and make it look like he knows what he's doing. Maybe like a fighter pilot trying to speak at an intelligence information conference. But there's another way to look at it, and that's the rock concert. Because you see, at the rock concert, everybody before the headliner are just warm-up bands. The main event is saved for last. So the organizers, I want to say, thank you for the rock star treatment. Thank you, Tampa! And next time, I want green M&Ms in the ante room before I come in. I got a couple of requests. Well, admittedly, I was a little intimidated about speaking at this conference, and I was hoping that there were others out there who are IT-challenged like me in the audience. So being the tech-savvy guy that I am, I pulled out my phone and I asked Siri. I said, hey, Siri, how many attendees at today's conference don't understand binary code? She replied, there's only one, which makes you a zero. I know, groan, right? My wife said, do not tell that joke. It's so corny. Sorry, it's best I got. Okay, so my programming skills may have atrophied a bit since my college days of Peach Text, Pascal, and Fortran, and some of you out there are old enough to remember those things. But I think I do understand warfighting and have come to realize the incredibly important role that cyber and information warfare play now will continue to play as both state and, importantly, non-state actors look for ways to balance our conventional capabilities with these so-called asymmetric means. Asymmetric warfare is now and will continue to be used by nation states like Iran and North Korea, by powerful near-peer competitors like Russia and China, as well as by super-empowered individuals who act on their own agendas or in support of transnational threats such as ISIS or Al-Qaeda. They're competing below the levels of armed conflict, taking advantage of the ubiquity of cyberspace, the low cost of entry with disproportionate effects, and the difficulty with the attrition of a cyber bullet to a cyber trigger puller. They operate in this gray zone through covert and overt means, including the use of disinformation, cyber attacks, economic pressure, deployment of irregular, armed, and proxy groups. And they can sow doubt into the minds of affected populations and cause them to question their own political leadership and institutions. And this is the new normal that we face today, and we'll be facing for the foreseeable future, so we must be forward-thinking. This need to look ahead is reflected in Joe McKenzie, the CENTCOM commander's priorities for CENTCOM. The command's top strategic priority is Iran, while our top functional priority is countering these asymmetric threats, such as cyber and the explosion of unmanned aerial systems operating throughout our AOR. Today's strategic environment is obviously very complex and volatile, but the threats to our national interests are laid out clearly in the National Defense Strategy. And it's worth noting that five of the major issues identified in the NDS, competition with China, Russia, WMD, North Korea, Iran's morogue and malign activities, and violent extremist organizations, Four of those reside or significantly affect the central region. And the NDS focuses on problem solving of our eroding U.S. military advantage over China and Russia, which has been emboldening competitors and adversaries to challenge the free and open international order and U.S. alliance and partnership network. Now, for the past few decades, we've enjoyed dominant, often uncontested superiority in almost every operating domain, land, sea, air, even cyberspace. We could deploy where we wanted, when we wanted, and operate however we wanted. We used to be able to look up to the stars with certain knowledge that we were absolutely dominant in space, but today all those domains are now contested. Now contested because our adversaries have carefully studied the American way of war, and principally in the CENTCOM theater. They watch us in Desert Storm and OIF, OER, or OIR, and every other conflict we've been engaged in since the end of the Cold War. They've looked at what they perceive to be our vulnerabilities. They've developed capabilities that are designed specifically to disrupt our ability to operate freely across every domain. They've made significant adaptations and accelerated their modernization programs, assisted by a staggering degree of outright theft of U.S. intellectual property to asymmetrically counter our ability to project power. They've also carefully analyzed our limits of combat power. They've deduced our red lines and have consequently become masters of operating below them in this gray zone, in that space below armed conflict, and slightly above what was previously considered normal statecraft. They employ asymmetric warfare in an attempt to erode our strength, erode our confidence, and erode our will, all while avoiding decisive military confrontation. In this environment, the cyberspace domain is an important tool and will be increasingly leveraged. Growing connectivity throughout the globe presents some great opportunities, but those opportunities come with some significant risks. Many nations, including several in CENTCOM's AOR, are looking to Chinese and Russian companies like Huawei and Kaspersky to provide the commercial software and hardware required to build their telecommunications infrastructure. These developments not only threaten U.S. economic influence, but also provide concerns about cybersecurity and protecting our networks forward in partner nations. Here are but a few examples of our adversaries operating effectively in the gray zone. As early as 2008, Russia was able to infiltrate U.S. networks when a flash drive was inserted into a U.S. military computer in the CENTCOM AOR. That led to a massive remediation effort and dramatically influenced U.S. cybersecurity posture, and I'm here to probably with many of you who have never used a flash drive since. The next example should be eye-opening for everyone. Russia employed the most devastating cyber attack in history in June of 2017. It began as an assault on Ukraine, but its effects were felt around the globe. It was described by cyber experts as the equivalent of using a nuclear bomb to achieve a small tactical victory, and the attack is known as NotPetya. Now, there's probably many of you who have read Wired magazine, but for those that haven't and aren't familiar with the cyber attack, there's a really great article in that magazine, and if you haven't read it, I highly recommend you do. I'll give you a quick synopsis. Russia had been using their years-long conflict with Ukraine as a scorched-earth testing ground for their cyber tactics, including hacking into dozens of Ukrainian governmental organizations and destroying terabytes of data. They caused widespread power outages during the winter months to inflict pain upon the people, eroding their trust in the government's ability to protect them and provide essential services. NotPetya was designed to penetrate through a piece of accounting software that is used extensively in Ukraine, similar to our use of TurboTax or Quicken. It is used by nearly everyone filing taxes or doing business in Ukraine. The cyber attack worked by employing two different hacking exploits. The first was a penetration tool known as Eternal Blue that exploited a Windows vulnerability. The second tool was called Mimikatz. It was used to steal user credentials to hack into other machines on a network. Now, Microsoft created patches for the vulnerabilities exposed by Eternal Blue when it became known in 2017, but of course, not all computers had these updates. As a reminder, download your updates. And once NotPetya had access to an unpatched computer, it could use Mimikatz to pull off passwords to gain access into machines that were already patched. NotPetya got its name from a previous ransomware software known as Petya. Petya was a piece of criminal code released the year prior that would lock out users of their accounts and demand a fee for a key to unlock their files. NotPetya provided a similar ransom message, but it was never intended to provide a fix. Its goal was purely destructive. It was designed to attack computers' operating systems, and there was no fix. So how did this attack have an effect that was likened to a nuclear bomb? Well, first, it was highly effective against its intended target in Ukraine. It hit at least 4 hospitals in Kiev, 6 power companies, 2 airports, and more than 20 Ukrainian banks. It shut down ATMs and credit card payments across the country and effectively shut down the government. Over 300 Ukrainian companies were hit, and a government official estimated over 10% of all computers in the nation were affected. The speed of the intrusion and its spread was unprecedented. It took less than 45 seconds to bring down the network of a large Ukrainian bank. Unfortunately for the rest of the world, there was a single computer in the Black Sea coastal town of Odessa that contained the accounting software that NotPetya used for access. And the software had been installed by Maersk IT administrators at the request of one of their financial executives. And that's all it took. Maersk is the largest shipping conglomerate in the world. They have nearly 80,000 employees across 8 business units, ranging from ports to drilling to logistics in 130 countries across the globe. And they have a lot of computers, about 45,000 PCs, 4,000 servers, with about 150 domain controllers. And although the intrusion did not directly affect Maersk ships, it did affect 17 of their 76 terminals and ports around the world. And as a result, ships were unable to communicate their contents to the terminals. Sprawling fields of containers were stacked 8 high over square miles of shipyards, with no way of knowing their contents without opening them individually. Trucks were arriving with new containers, and not only was there no way to read their barcodes, the gates were electronically locked, creating massive traffic jams of hundreds of semi-trucks trying to get into the port and unable to turn around. And Maersk was not the only company affected. It hit everything from hospitals in Pennsylvania to chocolate factories in Tasmania. Multinational companies like Maersk, FedEx's European subsidiary TNT Express, French construction company Saint-Gobain, food producer Mondelez, pharmaceutical company Merck, and manufacturer Reckitt Benckiser were all hit with hundreds of millions of dollars in damages each. It even bounced back to Russia, striking the state oil company Rosneft. As you might imagine, Maersk experienced a significant drop in their operations worldwide as they scrambled to maintain orders through personal emails and resort to hard copy shipping manifests. They managed to rebuild their network in just 10 days, although it would take about 2 months to completely rebuild their software setup. Now, as many of you know, in production or project management, there's 3 main variables: are quality, time, and cost. So said another way, the goal is always to produce something good, fast, and cheap. But because of the need for speed in this instance, the solution was not cheap. The cost to Maersk were estimated at over $300 million, and some say that estimate is low. In all, NotPetya was estimated to cost companies around the world over $10 billion in damages, and it continues to inflict costs for those preparing to prevent future attacks. In fact, last year, Forbes magazine estimated that banks, JP Morgan, Chase, and Bank of America spent about $500 million each on cybersecurity, and that the private sector would spend over $1 trillion by 2021. I guess I'm in the wrong business. Our adversaries impose these costs while investing relatively little in developing these capabilities. Now, NotPetya was clearly a major act of aggression, but was it an act of war? After the attack, Cisco's Craig Williams argued that the Russians knew full well the extent of the pain and damage a cyber attack would inflict internationally, meant to punish anyone doing business with Ukraine. And clearly, Russia is not alone. All the other adversaries mentioned in the NDS, China, Iran, North Korea, some violent extremist organizations continue to pursue increasingly advanced cyber capabilities to impose those disproportionate costs. Iran, our number one long-term security challenge within the CENTCOM AOR, has increased funding for its cyber efforts 12-fold in recent years. The U.S. government publicly issued indictments for members of Iran's Revolutionary Guard Corps for conducting distributed denial of service attacks against U.S. banks going back to 2007. Their suspected role in attacks in Saudi Arabia's Aramco are well documented. The Shamoon malware spread to 35,000 computers belonging to Saudi Aramco in 2012, and 2 weeks later, Qatari gas company RasGas was also infected, resulting in the deletion of data. Recently, a cybersecurity firm known as FireEye published a report of suspected Iranian cyber actors using LinkedIn to lure victims to join professional network to send the victim emails with malware-laden attachments that would be able to gain user credentials from the victims. Furthermore, Wall Street Journal reported in July Bahrain's Electric and Water Authority and several Bahraini government agencies were also targeted by alleged Iranian cyber actors. The cyber actors were able to shut down several systems and obtain command and control of some of the systems. Cybersecurity experts believe Iran was using Bahraini networks because of their capability to disrupt critical infrastructure. But our adversaries not only challenge us in cyberspace, they also seek to impose disproportionate costs on the physical battlefield. These costs have both an economic price tag and a very real cost in blood. At an operational level, our forces face an asymmetric threat on the battlefield that I believe will be a growing concern over the coming years, the use of unmanned aerial systems, or UAS. This threat ranges from improvised, cheap, off-the-shelf drones, as we saw ISIS use in Iraq and Syria, to more advanced systems that are being developed and provided by Iran to its proxies like the Houthis in Yemen. Our adversaries use them not only to conduct reconnaissance, but also to drop improvised explosives on friendly forces, as well as kamikaze-style attacks on partner nations' infrastructure. Houthi rebels claim to successfully launch attacks against Saudi Aramco oil refineries outside of Riyadh, and that they successfully attacked the Abu Dhabi International Airport in UAE, which suggests a range of almost 1,500 kilometers. Iran's role in advancing the capabilities and employment of UAS in Yemen is not unlike the role they played in the development of other asymmetric capabilities, such as advanced improvised explosive devices, specifically explosively formed penetrators, or EFPs, that were used against our forces in Iraq. During Operation Iraqi Freedom, we assessed hundreds of U.S. personnel deaths in Iraq were the result of Iran-backed militants' use of various asymmetric weapons, including EFPs. Now, just like every threat our nation has faced throughout its history, we rally and we met the challenge of IEDs head-on to find a solution. We rapidly fielded the mine-resistant ambush-protected vehicles, better known as MRAPs. From 2007 to 2012, we fielded over 12,000 MRAPs to forces operating in Iraq and Afghanistan. It may not have been the perfect vehicle, but there's no doubt that it saved countless American lives and forced our adversaries to adjust their tactics against us. Now, the MRAP was a good vehicle for its purpose, and it was fielded very quickly and under duress. But as I mentioned earlier, when dealing with the three constraints of project management, quality, time, and cost, you only get to choose two when operating under crisis. So while the MRAP was a good vehicle and it was fielded quickly, it certainly was not cheap. The program cost approximately $50 billion for 27,000 vehicles. So how does the MRAP analogy apply to the current asymmetric threats we face, like UAS? Well, like EFP, the UAS is becoming the asymmetric weapon of choice for state and non-state actors in CENTCOM. And there are hundreds of UAS we track from multiple different origins, which are engaged in surveillance, disruption, and destruction of U.S. interests every single day in our AOR. And our capacity to defend against them currently has limits. And there's no doubt in my mind that our forces will face an ever-increasing threat of UAS on the battlefield in both terms of numbers and capability. And so now we need an MRAP-like effort to counter this emerging technology and prevent the costs that could be imposed not only on U.S. forces and U.S. interests, but to the international community. And while time is of the essence, I'm convinced that there are solutions available that won't break the bank. Now, some of the best and perhaps least costly solutions will likely be non-kinetic solutions, and this is going to require military, legal, industry, and in political minds to come together on a focused effort to tackle this vexing problem, and we need to act now. Now, since 2001 and the aftermath of 9/11, CENTCOM has been charged with the responsibility of commanding multiple, often simultaneous combat missions in the central region. We recognize the strategic importance of the central region to our national interests, and we will continue to face multiple adversaries operating in the Middle East. Together, we will find solutions to the evolving asymmetric threats that our adversaries will field. So I want to thank you for all that you do to support our forces, especially those operating in CENTCOM. It's been an honor to spend some time with you. Look forward to any questions you might have. And one more thing, when you're filling out your critiques at the end, just please either grade me a 1 or a 0, or you could go 1 and a 0 right next to each other. Okay, thank you very much, Champ. I appreciate it. Yeah. So I'm happy to stay up here if there happens to be any questions. We're a little bit ahead of schedule, but we're also at the end of the program. So, but if you, anybody have any questions for me, give you 5 seconds. Okay, great. Thank you very much. This is easy. Okay, thank you. There's always one, Horshack, for those that can remember that. Okay, who had the question? Yes, please, sir. Yeah, I apologize. It's really hard to hear from here without a mic. Can somebody relay the question to me, please? Hardware integrity, how do you keep it in check? Well, I wish my J6 was here. Is my J6 here? There he is. That's how the DCOM does it. I turn to the J6. Come on up, General Ray, the J6 of all U.S. CENTCOM. Come on up, my friend.
Hey, good afternoon, everybody. Oh, thank you. So what we're doing is we're working with industry, obviously, to harden our infrastructure that we have currently. So what we need from our partners and the industry environment is better ways to, protect our data. Because we believe it's about the data. It's not really anymore about the transport. It's not really more about anything. But we need a data where we can displace it around the world and use our transports around the world to get to our data. But we need the protection of the data and the ability to access that data around the world. So we're asking our partners to help us with that. And to harden our infrastructure, we just continue to use the current tools that we have in place. But again, the most important thing today is about the data, not the transport.
Yeah, I would just add one more thing, and that is the integrity of the supply chain that goes into development of whatever, hardware it is. That's really, critically important. The contractors and subs to subs to subs who are producing that one piece that could be the thing that the straw that broke the camel's back. So great question. Thank you. Good answer. Okay, any other questions? Okay, sir, thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity.
All right, let's give another round of applause for General Bergeson and his J6. All right. Thank you again. So I opened up by saying that for me, this conference is a source for understanding how we might apply innovative ideas and capabilities to solve some of our most pressing challenges. And I certainly saw this during the week. As we close out this third day, I want to thank Ann Lamoureux, who's in charge of our CIO communications team, as well as her whole team for helping us put together this conference. I thought it turned out great. Thank you. And I also want to thank NCSI for helping us pull this together. As I mentioned, this is our 16th year holding it, although I did hear from someone last night that was a part of DoDIIS since the very beginning that we, all in all, if you counted every session where we started this internally, It's been 24 years, which is quite some time, but officially 16 years pulling everybody in industry together. This has been our largest conference in the past decade. We've had over 3,600 people attend this week, which was a great turnout. You know, I hope even next year it'll be even bigger. As we close the week, each year we pull together a closing video, which captures all of the moments and the new technologies and ideas that we've shared during the week. And I'd like to introduce that video right now before we introduce Mr. Jack Cumdow. So let's play that, please.
Good morning, and welcome to Tampa for the start of the 2019 DoDIIS Worldwide Conference.
DoDIIS is the largest technology conference in the IC. It's really the source for understanding how we might apply some of the most innovative ideas and capabilities to solve some of our most pressing challenges.
DoDIIS Worldwide Conference cultivates a collaborative environment for having that consistent and deliberate conversation in regards to cybersecurity. You have innovators, subject matter experts, government, military, and civilian counterparts here to discuss their own personal experience when it comes to cybersecurity so that we can counter the unconventional warfare of asymmetric threats within the intelligence community.
As technology evolves, our use of that technology evolves as well. And with each evolution comes new industries that help service the capabilities that we need. DoDIIS brings that all together in one place.
Just think about all the information that's out there. 2.5 quintillion bytes of data created every day. Where is that data going and who's controlling it?
More than 100 million Capital One customers.
Hackers to remote spyware.
Asymmetric threats are coming at us from a variety of different ways in different threat vectors, different speeds. This is special operations warfare, fighting terrorist activities that are not army on army, tank on tank.
Over the past several decades, the threat landscape has changed drastically. We've gone from living in an environment with not a lot of data to an environment to where now data is plentiful. We can't address the changing threat environment alone. It's a partnership with industry, it's a partnership across government agencies, and it's a partnership with academia.
In today's connected environment, often people think, I don't wear a uniform. I don't work for the government. Therefore, America's adversaries, they wouldn't be interested in coming after my data. They wouldn't be interested in coming after my networks or my systems. The reality is, we live in a world today where adversaries do not distinguish. They have taken the cyber domain and they've weaponized it.
As we face state actors, non-state actors, people who are coming at us from all angles, we need to be able to protect our network, protect our resources so that we remain with the decision advantage.
The adversary is not going to go away. You have to be ready. The best way to do that is for us to be ready together. That's why what we do here is so important. The networks and the systems that we create implement a digital environment of safety, a thought space, where leaders, policymakers, warfighters, and decision makers can come together and know that safety is a reality.
It will take our industry partners, it will take military, it will take government, and take academia to help the warfighter get after what it is that we need to accomplish.
We have to move beyond and prevent against the notion that cyber, digital, information technology wouldn't become a part of the warfare that we're going to see in the future. And that starts with each and every one of us.
It's not about DIA CIO being successful. It's about us as joint partners supporting the DoD, the IC, and this nation together.
I am DIA.
I am DIA.
I am DIA.
I am a DIA officer.
A DIA officer.
A DIA officer.
I am an officer at DIA.
We are DIA.
So I'd be remiss if I didn't take the opportunity to share a fun fact about Jack as well, as I did with every other speaker. Many of you may not know that he fancies himself as a carpenter, home improvement. Luckily, we were able to capture a picture of him working on a shed 2 years ago where he fell off the roof and broke his ankle. So without further ado, please welcome Jack Gumtow back to the stage.
I don't know if this is this on? Yeah, I love the Photoshop because that is definitely not my house. And I did fall off the roof a couple years ago. I was putting up the starting to shingle it, and I put the underlayment on, and I was standing on it. It ripped away. It was like glass, and it shattered my tibia going down. But that's okay. Hey, that was a great video. I mean, really, it was a great video. I watched this last night. They were like, hey, you've got to come down. I was at the one social, you got to come down and see this. And I was like, I don't really need to see this. You know, I'm not going to chop it. It's okay what you put in here. Because you guys always do a great job of that. I just don't want to go up here and be surprised at something that's going to surprise me. Where's Megan? Megan, come on up. And I also want to bring up Valerie and Crystal. Come on up. So the opening video was done, and I talked about that at the beginning of this when I opened it up by Crystal. You had a big hand in it, and Valerie, you did as well, doing that. It was the first year, I believe, that we've done this in-house, and usually it's done separately. You guys did a fantastic job, and I want to say thank you and give you my coin. Thank you. And Megan, it, as always, it's been very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll give you the coin, too.
Thank you.
I know you like to come up here in the limelight, but...
Yeah.
So... So I'm not going to stand up here and talk long. Everybody wants to go. You got things to do, better places to be. Thank you for sticking it out at the last few minutes of this. When I stood up here on Monday, this place was pretty well packed. Now it's like, okay, you guys, good job for sticking around. I think what I really want to say is thank you for coming and being part of this. This is not about just DIA or DIA-CIO. It's about us together in a joint endeavor, working together in a partnership to further the mission of this country, period. And I talk to other people about it. I know sometimes it sounds corny, but that's really the core of who I am and where I want to go. And it's about all of us together, and however we serve, uniform, non-uniform, vendor, academia, and quite frankly, our Five Eyes foreign partners. We're all in it together, and thank you. Doug told you we had 3,600 participants, large conference. I think that worked out well. There was fantastic exhibits. There was great conversations. I engaged in a number of them with a number of people. There was lots of what I'll call reciprocal learning, because it's not just about us learning. Sorry about that. It's also about you learning from us, and we together learning different things and moving the ball forward. And the last thing that's important for me is the networking. So sometimes we're apart for a year, and we come back together, and it's like we haven't been gone for 364 days. And we come back together, and it just renews those connections, and it helps further those partnerships. And then there's the new ones that always get developed by bringing people together in one place to address these issues of common concern. So for me, the value proposition for this conference that always remains is about that reciprocal learning. It promotes DIA as a entity, because it's not the Denver International Airport, it's the Defense Intelligence Agency that we get out there. And all of this has been streamed out to the internet. I did watch the video, the CIO panel that was yesterday. I thought it was a good panel, although I did skip through really fast of anything that I said because I really don't want to see myself talk or see myself on screen. It's not happy. And the last part of the value proposition is how we enhance our partnerships. And that's, I think you're going to hear that as a recurring theme. You've heard it from me from the beginning. You will continue to hear that over and over again. It is about partnerships. None of us can do anything individually. So let me see. I have a couple bullets on the screen that I want to talk about. And I really want to end this with saying thank you. And kind of the charge, and they wanted to bring this up, but hopefully they're not going to. As we move forward, and I talked about pizza and beer, you know, we would deliver pizza. They really wanted beer. It kind of resonated with a few people. And what they really want, listen. They want both pizza and beer. That's okay. Deliver what they ask for, not what we think is best for them. And so with that, thank you. Safe travels. And I'll see you next year in Phoenix.